Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
We gather now in what used to be known as Passiontide, that time in the church's year to focus fully on the passion of Christ, that we may know the forgiveness of our sins. Now to prepare ourselves for the celebration of these sacred mysteries, let us acknowledge our sins. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary ever Virgin, all of the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Are shut and no one can see us.
give in to our desire and lie with us. If you refuse, we will testify against you that you dismissed your maids because a young man was here with you. I am completely trapped, Susanna groaned. If I yield, it will be my death. If I refuse, I cannot escape your power. Yet it is better for me to fall into your power without guilt than to sin before the Lord. Then Susanna shrieked, and the old man also shouted at her, as one of them ran to open the garden doors. When the people in the house heard the cries from the garden, they rushed in by the side gate to see what had happened to her. At the accusations by the old man, the servants felt very much ashamed, for never had any such thing been said about Susanna. When the people came to her husband Joachim the next day, the two wicked elders also came, fully determined to put Susanna to death. Before all the people, they ordered, "Send for Susanna, the daughter of Hilkiah, the wife of Joachim." When she was sent for, she came with her parents, children, and all her relatives. All her relatives and the onlookers were weeping. In the midst of the people, the two elders rose up and laid their hands on her head. Through tears, she looked up to heaven, for she trusted in the Lord wholeheartedly. The elders made this accusation. As we were walking in the garden alone, this woman entered with two girls and shut the doors of the garden, dismissing the girls. A young man who was hidden there came and lay with her. When we, in a corner of the garden, saw this crime, we ran towards them. We saw them lying together, but the man we could not hold because he was stronger than we. He opened the doors and ran off. Then we seized her and asked who the young man was, but she refused to tell us. We testified to this. The assembly believed them, since they were elders and judges of the people, and they condemned her to death. But Susanna cried aloud, "O eternal God, you know what is hidden, and are aware of all things before they come to be. You know that they have testified falsely against me. Here I am about to die, though I have done none of the things with which these wicked men have charged me." The Lord heard her prayer. As she was being led to execution, God stirred up the Holy Spirit of a young boy named Daniel, and he cried aloud, "I will have no part in the death of this woman." All the people turned and asked him, "What is this you are saying?" He stood in their midst and continued, "Are you such fools, O children of Israel, to condemn a woman of Israel without examination and without clear evidence? Return to court, for they have testified falsely against her." Then all the people returned in haste. To Daniel, the elder said, "Come, sit with us and inform us, since God has given you the prestige of old age." But he replied, "Separate these two far from each other, that I may examine them." After they were separated one from the other, he called one of them and said, "How you have grown evil with age. Now have your past sins come to term, passing unjust sentences, condemning the innocent, and freeing the guilty. Although the Lord says, the innocent and the just you shall not put to death. Now then, if you were a witness, tell me under what tree you saw them together." "Under a mastic tree," he answered. Daniel replied, "Your fine lie has cost you your head, for the angel of God shall receive the sentence from him and split you in two." Putting him to one side, he ordered the other one to be brought. Daniel said to him, "Offspring of Canaan, not of Judah, beauty has seduced you. Lust has subverted your conscience. This is how you acted with the daughters of Israel, and in their fear they yielded to you. But a daughter of Judah did not tolerate your wickedness. Now then, tell me under what tree you surprised them together." "Under an oak," he said. Daniel replied, "Your fine lie has cost you also your head, for the angel of God waits with the sword to cut you in two so as to make an end of you both." The whole assembly cried aloud, blessing God who saves those who hope in him. They rose up against the two elders, for by their own words Daniel had convicted them of perjury. According to the law of Moses, they inflicted on them the penalty they had plotted to impose on their neighbor. They put them to death. Thus was innocent blood spared that day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side.
Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. Beside restful waters he leads me, he refreshes my soul.
Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side.
He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side, with your rod and your staff that gives me courage.
Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side.
You spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side.
Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come.
Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. went to the Mount of Olives. But early in the morning, he arrived again in the temple area, and all the people started coming to him, and he sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery and made her stand in the middle. They said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say?" They said this to test him, so that they could have some charges to bring against him. Jesus bent down and began to write on the ground with his finger. But when they continued asking him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let the one among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." Again he bent down and wrote on the ground. And in response, they went away one by one, beginning with the elders. So he was left alone with the woman before him. Then Jesus straightened up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She replied, "No one, sir." Then Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, do not sin anymore." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. The reading that, for all intents and purposes, takes up almost the entirety of the 13th chapter of the prophet Daniel, that Father Martin so wonderfully proclaimed this morning in all of its length, would make a good episode of Law and Order. The crime is supposedly committed, but in fact it never actually occurs. But these two elders nonetheless bring an accusation against the woman who is described to be God-fearing, Susanna. Along comes this young boy, probably a teenager. His name is Daniel. It is he whom the book is named for, and it is at this point that he comes on the scene in the book in order to show that with him, God is lifting his words, his hopes, his desires to bring truth and justice to this situation. But this will lead then Daniel to become a prophet amongst the people of God as they are in the Babylonian exile. It's an interesting reading to be proclaimed on this first weekday of Passion Time, in which in the calendar prior to the changes of the Second Vatican Council was a season within a season, Passion Time within Lent. We would have walked into our churches yesterday and seen the crucifixes and all of the images of the saints covered in purple cloth. Those images are covered in order to help us begin to fully focus our attention on the passion and death of Christ. That will be our focus in the church's liturgy over these next 2 weeks. So what is it about this reading and the complimentary one that comes from John 8 about the woman caught in adultery that Jesus forgives? Why would these be chosen on this first weekday of Passion Tide? First of all, because that passage from the book of Daniel wants us to know that God is about truth. God is also about justice. And in the case of a woman like Susanna, who really had almost no standing in the law, the elders who practiced the law day and night, These men seem, at least by many, to be upright themselves, but we're told in the reading that they truly have wicked hearts. This woman comes to know the love of God because she puts her trust completely in Him, knowing that the law He has given through Moses ultimately brings about all righteousness, all truth. Is it any reason that Jesus Himself says in the Gospel, "I have not come to abolish the law, I have come to fulfill the law"? The fulfillment of the law is when we, even in our trials and tribulations, find truth and justice from God alone. One of the books that I use in order to look at the scripture readings for each day, in it I have a holy card from Blessed Aloysius Stepinac. He was the Cardinal Archbishop of Zagreb in Yugoslavia. His story is somewhat similar to that of Susanna. He found himself in Yugoslavia, a country that would be overrun by the communists after the Second World War. He was eventually accused by the communists, who had no time for institutional religion of any kind, especially of the Catholic Church. He was accused of citing disunity in the country because of his constant promotion of the Catholic faith. The communist regime eventually arrested him and put him in kind of a show trial beginning in the fall of 1946. The reason this story becomes such of an interest to people in our diocese is because at the time, the bishop of our diocese, Joseph Hurley, was still serving in the Vatican Diplomatic Corps, and he was sent by Pope Pius XII to be the papal representative to the trial. And even though the communist judges forbade anyone to give any kind of reference or respect to Stepinac, every time he walked into the courtroom, Bishop Hurley stood and bowed to the man who had been condemned by the communists. Stepinac was eventually found guilty. He was sentenced to 16 years of hard labor. But in 1951, because of ill health, the communists decide to commute the sentence to house arrest. He eventually died in February of 1960. And John Paul II, who we all know had no time for the communist regime, went to Zagreb in October of 1998 and beatified Aloysius Stepinac. There are stories of many saints of our church who have known injustice but stayed the course in trusting in God. These stories today are placed before us because Jesus Himself knew that same fate. Charged with a crime He did not commit, He continued to put His trust in Almighty God. In these difficult times, these stories continue to tell us to do the same thing, to praise our God for His blessings and goodness to us, and in our trials and distress, place our full trust in Him, to cry out to Him in our darkness, and know that He is with us with His grace. We are gathered as one family. To our God we lift up our prayers.
For Pope Francis and all clergy, may God's hope shine abundantly through them as they lead the church and the world today. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are elected to government positions, God's justice be in their hearts as they make decisions in the best interests of all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who thirst for light in situation of great darkness, may God's love lead them to everlasting life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all in our faith community, may the Lord help us to always grow in faith, hope, and love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For medical professionals, that God may guide their hands and hearts, and that they may be protected from sickness as they care for those afflicted. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the faithful departed, especially Stephen Reyes, may God's peace be with them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty and living God, we humbly place these, our prayers, before you. Hear and answer them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. In your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God in heaven.
Pray that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his people.
Grant, we pray, O Lord, that preparing to celebrate the holy mysteries, we may bring before you as the fruit of bodily penance a joyful purity of heart through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For through the saving passion of your Son, the whole world has received a heart to confess the infinite power of your majesty. Since, by the wondrous power of the cross, your judgment on the world is now revealed and the authority of Christ crucified. And so, Lord, with the angels and the saints, we too give you thanks as an exaltation we acclaim. Beginning, are ceaselessly at work, so that the human race may become holy just as you yourself are holy. Look, we pray, upon your people's offerings, and pour out on them the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we too are your sons and daughters. Indeed, though we once were lost and could not approach you, you loved us with the greatest love. For your Son, who alone is just, handed himself over to death and did not disdain to be nailed for our sake to the wood of the cross. But before his arms were outstretched between heaven and earth to become the lasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover with his disciples. As he ate with them, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, knowing he was about to reconcile all things in himself through his blood to be shed on the cross, he took the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, and once more giving you thanks, handed the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world. For by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Passover and our surest peace, we celebrate his death and resurrection from the dead. And looking forward to his blessed coming, we offer you, who are our faithful and merciful God, this sacrificial victim who reconciles to you the human race. Look kindly, most compassionate Father, on those you unite to yourself by the sacrifice of your Son. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, that they may be gathered into one body in Christ who heals every division.
Be pleased to keep us always in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis, our Pope, and Felipe, our Bishop. Help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom until the hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints in the halls of heaven, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the blessed apostles, and all the saints, and with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we humbly commend to your mercy. Then freed at last from the wound of corruption and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ who lives for all eternity.
Through him, with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Now at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
O Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, and my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Let us pray. Strengthened by the blessing of your sacraments, we pray, O Lord, that through them we may constantly be cleansed of our faults, and by following Christ, hasten our steps upward toward you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit. Bow down for the blessing.
Set free from their sins, O Lord, we pray, the people who call upon you, that living a holy way of life, they may be kept safe from every trial through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you forever.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord.